I'm walking and talking, yeah. Walking and talking with my mind, yes, I am. Stayed on speed. That's what you. Walking and talking with my mind. Ooh, ooh, ooh.
Stayed on speed.
Hey, Annie, walking and talking with my daughter, Christine. Stay on speed. I see you, Lavelle. I see you, Donna. Singing my song, yeah, singing my song with my mind, sing along with me, stay on spirit, singing my song with my mind, ooh, ooh, ooh. Stay on spirit.
Welcome to the Center for Spiritual Living Kelowna. My name is Barbara Samuel. This is Neal Klassen, and we are here to serve you this morning. We're going to sing a song called There Is Only Love.
In this moment, in this place, I remember letting fear and worry fall away from me. I open my eyes and see there is only love.
Hey, Mom, Jenny Klassen.
There is only love that
good morning, everyone, and it is a delight to see all of you here this morning. And what a beautiful song to bring us into this, what feels like a new time to me. So welcome to our online celebration of the Center for Spiritual Living Kelowna. And I'm glad you're here now, and I'm glad if you visit us later on YouTube as well, or somehow I think our talks are archived on Facebook Live as well, but then they're not live, so there you go. So if you are here this morning and your phone is nearby, and if you think that you might know somebody who could benefit by hearing something inspirational and life-giving this morning, I want you to just take that second and pick up your phone and just send them a really quick text and invite them to join us, our service here today. So just a thought, you know, we have our phones like so close to us, and I don't know about you, but I really had my phone close to me this whole weekend. So if you want to do that, that would just be a fun thing. And so I want to begin our time today by acknowledging that this coming Wednesday is the day when we hold the men and the women who have served our country in our hearts, and we offer our gratitude. And so I want to say thank you on behalf of the entire world for those who have defended our freedoms. And I also want to congratulate the United States on their new president and vice president-elects. This crowd liked it. You know, I could not believe how personally emotional I was hearing both Biden and Harris's speeches. And just for myself personally, I gotta say, it felt like moving toward that world that works for all. And so I'm grateful. And so giving a presence to all that is happening really fits in well with our monthly theme of living as compassionate conduits. And goodness knows, of late, the world has been in need of some conduiting, some compassion. And I know that Neal Klassen, who will be sharing our message this morning, is going to somehow connect compassion and love with monsters. So that will be in a few minutes, but I can't wait. So a few things going on that might make a difference in your world. So the first, now this is tentative, but I keep thinking if we plant the seed, it will be our reality. So if you read my Happy Monday this week, we're doing a save the date for December the 20th for our 28th annual Celebration of Life holiday service. So fingers crossed, we are going to be able to do two separate shows of $50 each, and it's going to be live at the Rotary Center, and we're going to add some other things in, but you got to kind of wait and see for some of this. But as always, we are safety first, so you got to stay tuned, but do write December the 20th on your calendar. I am also really, really pleased that we're going to be able to offer a 4-week drop-in grief support work coming up. So this will be facilitated by our licensed practitioner, Pauline Weniger, and she'll be joined by Reverends Diane Hockey and Melody Bailey. And this is going to be on Zoom Wednesday evening, starting November the 18th at 7 o'clock. You'll have to check our website for the details, that's cslkelowna.org, and you can get the Zoom information and all of this. And I am really so very grateful for them for offering this at this time. You know, it's my personal belief that a lot of us are grieving a lot of losses, kind of loss on top of loss at this time of so much change. So this will be a safe place to share, to listen, and to receive compassionate support. And there is no cost, but always donations are welcome. And finally, you are all invited to attend our weekly pre-service Sunday morning meditation time at 7:45, and that also is on Zoom. You can check our website for details on that. So with all of that said, I would just like to lead us into the rest of this morning with a little bit of a sort of a meditative here and now spiritual practice. So if you'd like to join me, I would love if you would just close your eyes in order to bring your attention to that beautiful inside stillness. And I invite you to just take a deep breath and another breath. And as you do, just acknowledge this moment, this right here, right now moment, and know that in this split second of time, each of us is totally enough for this moment. We have enough. We are enough. And in this second, we claim our wholeness, our peace, and our good. And so let's know for each of us that we have everything we need here and now. And I claim for us an increased knowingness of this perfection. And so one more deep breath. I know that we have everything we need for every future moment of time as well. Everything. And so let's give thanks for claiming the fullness of this moment and the moment of power going forward into our lives, our day, and our world. And so it is.
And so it is. In this very room, there's quite enough love for all the world. And in this very room, there's quite enough joy for all the world. And there's quite enough peace and quite enough power to walk through our every fear. For spirit, one spirit is in this very room. We are one, we are one. I am you, you are me, we are one. And in this unity, we do live in harmony, and peace must come as we are one.
Would you stand with me where you are?
This sacred moment of now, I take a breath and I let my eyes fall soft and I relax my shoulders and I turn my attention within to the consciousness that is God individualized as me. It is a consciousness of love. It is a consciousness of creativity. It is a consciousness of clarity. And I know that there is life and only one life. And it is God and it is given to me to enjoy as creator of my experience. Oh, today I awaken to the glorious gift that is mine, and I open my eyes to God's magnificent creation that is everything and everyone, everywhere. I recognize the divine in all, and in this state of mind, I always choose those thoughts with which me command that law of mind to into action, to choose compassion, to choose clarity, to choose friendship, to choose kindness, to choose financial prosperity. And I am inspired today to take this action into the pursuit of my dreams, my professional dreams, my personal dreams. And it is easy for me to take this step. I know that this is the truth today as I seek the spiritual truth and I enjoy my curious mind as I allow more and more to be revealed. And I know that today Neal is a vessel, is a conduit of that wisdom, of that energy, that is spirit moving through him. It is with great gratitude that I am totally open and convinced that God is all there is and God is good all the time and all the time that God is good. I let it be, I let it rest. I know it to be my truth. And we say, and so it is. Let's sing one more song.
This light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. This little light of
shoulder, because you're going to let it shine. Ladies and gentlemen, it is my joy and my delight to welcome to the stage the one, the only, my favorite everything, Neal Klassen, and the crowd goes crazy.
Good morning, good morning, good morning. Wow, what a beautiful day it is. This is just, yeah, absolutely great. You know, when I was a kid, not so long ago, well, I guess it was a little while ago, you know, 10, 11, 12, 16, I believed in monsters. Like, I truly believed in monsters. Now, I want to make it clear, I'm not talking about fake monsters, like not Halloween monsters like Frankenstein or vampires. I didn't believe in those monsters. And I'm not talking about movie monsters like King Kong or Godzilla. I didn't believe in those monsters. No, I believed in the real monsters. You know, Ogopogo, Bigfoot, Loch Ness monsters. The real ones. Believed with my whole heart that they existed. Now, I was pretty serious about this stuff when I was a kid. And I was also a bit of a nerd when I was a kid. So I did my own research about monsters. So, you know, obviously I went to the library and I read the books and I watched movies when I could, but we didn't have the internet back then. So you really had to go out of your way to get information above and beyond what you could find in the library. And I was that kind of kid who did that. Now, of course, living in Southern Ontario, in St. Catharines, unfortunately, I lived far away from where those real monsters actually lived. So I actually had to reach out and make contact with people in those areas, like in British Columbia and in Scotland. I kid you not, I actually sent letters to local newspapers, city halls, chambers of commerce to get information to find somebody who might mail newspaper clippings or send me information, anything that I couldn't find in the books. So I actually still have a letter from the Kelowna Chamber of Commerce dated 1972. That includes an Ogopogo placemat. It was a cartoon drawing of Ogopogo with little sayings about what Ogopogo was. Somebody in the Kelowna Chamber of Commerce in 1972 answered my letter and sent this to me. I also have a series of autographed self-published books by a guy by the name of John Green. Now, John Green was a real Sasquatch hunter who lived in Harrison Hot Springs, and he self-published his books. He typed them all out. He autographed them and gave them to me. But my prized collection, my absolute pinnacle collection, is a series of postcards and newspaper clippings from Brother Adrian, who is a Scottish monk who lived at an abbey on the shores of Loch Ness. I kid you not, I actually corresponded with a Scottish monk. I was that much of a nerd. And I'm not talking 6, 7 years old. I'm talking 11, 12 years old. So, you know. But I can laugh at this now. But at the time, I really believed in those things. Or maybe I just wanted to believe them. Or, oh, I don't know, for some reason I needed to believe in them. I don't know. But, you know, as I got older, as we get older, we stop believing in some things. And we start believing in other things. These beliefs are the effects created by causes that we encounter in our lives. Causes like life, things that happen in life, divorce, financial challenges, health issues, relationship issues. These life events in themselves are not monsters. We all experience them. But the belief system that they can create are sometimes monstrous. I'm talking about belief systems like, I'm not worthy, I'm not lovable, I'm not abundant, I'm not enough. These beliefs are no more real than the Loch Ness Monster, Santa Claus, or the Easter Bunny. Don't say anything about Santa Claus to our grandkids. But they still affect our lives in negative ways. They're not real, but they affect our lives every day. So we all know about cause and effect. We learned it in science. If you hit a billiard ball with a cue, the ball moves. The first is the cause, the second is the effect. Ernest Holmes defined cause, I'm going to read this. Ernest Holmes defined cause as that which occasions or produces an effect, the reason, motivation, or occasion. Now, Holmes defined effect as that which did not make itself, but which must have a power back of it, causing it to be. He said, all manifestation is effect, and all effect is subject to its cause. Now, Ernest Holmes was never one who would use one word when he could use 7 or 12. His definition is just a fancy way of saying, if something happens, then something else will happen that was created by that thing that happens. And that something else that will happen is the effect, but we can control the effect. So let me see if I can explain this a bit better. In physical science, cause and effect is almost always predictable. When the temperature drops below freezing, fresh water freezes. Cause and effect. When you drop an object, it lands on the floor. Cause and effect. When I eat Barb's chocolate, she doesn't speak to me for a day. Cause and effect. Now, in behavioral science, though, the effect is not always predictable. A cause can have many different effects. And even though many of us, even the six in this room, experience the same causes, we don't all experience the same effects. Look at siblings, for example. We hear stories about siblings, I don't know, growing up in poverty. They grew up in the same home. The poverty is the cause of the effects. But those siblings, who all grew up in the same cause, often end up living very different lives. Some escape poverty, some not. That's the effect. So despite the similar upbringings, each of the siblings grow to have differing effects. And that's because for whatever reasons or circumstances, the different effects we experience create different belief systems for each of us. So I'm going to quickly review. There's a cause which has an outcome, and that outcome creates a belief system for us to explain that outcome. All of us share similar experiences, yet we have many different beliefs about those experiences. For example, we all know that just because the sun rises at the same time that the rooster crows, the rooster did not cause the sun to shine. We're a little bit smarter than that, hopefully. Yet in life, sometimes we confuse the effect with the cause that can create those belief systems that I'm talking about. Belief systems that are not based in truth, like the Loch Ness Monster. Belief systems that are actually based in a lack of understanding the truth. Am I making myself clear here? The filmmaker Guy Ritchie, you remember he was Madonna's husband for a while? He said this, he said, it's okay to have beliefs, just don't believe them. But actually, it's a really interesting paradoxical statement when you think of it. And it's also not bad advice when your old belief systems don't serve you anymore. Just like when I was a kid trying to figure out my place in the world, it served me at that time to believe in Ogopogo and Bigfoot. Gave me something to learn about. But I outgrew those beliefs in an intellectual and a healthy way. There are other beliefs, not so easy. I'm going to give you an example from my own life, and I wonder how many of you can relate to this. This belief is centered around relationships, specifically intimate relationships. Now, I've had quite a few relationships over the years, you know, girlfriends in high school and whatever going up through my adult years, but before I met Barb, none of them were lasting. And looking back on it now, I can actually see a pattern that I couldn't see when I was in it. And that was, in every one of my past relationships, I already knew that the other person was attracted to me before I entered to the relationship. So if somebody said, oh, that girl thinks you're cute or whatever, then I would approach that person. But I would never take a risk of approaching somebody just out of the blue and say, hey, would you like to go for dinner? Never in my life. I always had to have a pretty good shot at it before I would take a risk. So I already knew that the person liked me, so I didn't have to put myself out there. And beyond that, here's the effect. I entered into relationships with people I didn't even want to be in relationships with. I entered into relationships because they wanted me, not because I wanted them. So, and that's a really easy thing to do because there's no risk involved. But what's the outcome? The outcome is I'm constantly dissatisfied because I got into the relationship for the wrong reason. And ultimately, why did I do that? Because I was afraid of rejection. Probably because at the time, I didn't feel worthy of love. I was actually so surprised that somebody actually liked me that I would just jump on it. Wow, I can't believe it. You're my girlfriend now, you know? This sounds terrible, I know. And I apologize if any ex-girlfriends are watching this, but it didn't really matter if I liked that person or not. I even knew the relationship wouldn't last, and I still got into it. That's crazy. But that's what comes when you have such a strong belief system that doesn't serve you anymore. I can speak for myself, but I can always put out the question, has anyone up there ever settled for less than what they wanted or felt they deserved? I know I can't be the only one. That feeling of unworthiness, I don't know where it came from. It didn't really matter at a certain point, like why I entered into these relationships. What mattered was that I identified that monster and I fought it out of my life. I recognized that pattern and I saw it as a false belief system. And only when the monster was banished was I willing to take the risk and put myself out there to someone I cared for. Most of you know how well that actually turned out for me. Now I did take a risk, and Barb will tell you that story someday. I took a pretty big risk, but I put myself out from a place not of unworthiness, but a place of deservedness. Now, this isn't exactly a first world problem, a third world problem. You know, I know that I had it easy, and if that's my biggest complaint in life, that I wasn't satisfied with my relationships, I really didn't have a lot to complain about. So I've had a few monsters in my life that have created some unhealthy belief systems, but I know I got off easy. I never experienced physical or mental abuse, like I know some of you have. I never experienced neglect or pain as a child, like I know that some of you have. I know that when it comes to fighting those belief systems, I actually had a head start over a lot of people. And for that, I'm grateful. So let's jump to a minute to what Ernest Holmes believed. He said, in more than one word, I believe that the relationship between God and man is a direct one, and that the avenue through which the mind of God expresses to the mind of man is through the mind of man himself. Some of the religions that we were brought up on, certainly the one that I was brought up on, say that there's a separation between God and us, that God is, oh, there he is over there, or there he is up there, and here I am over here, or here I am down here. There's a separation. And that God is exerting his will upon us. We've heard that term, God's will, as if it's a force, or God, it's a plan. Some believe that God is like God's will is a series of choices that are already made for us. Kind of like he's a cosmic hockey coach who decides who plays and who gets benched. You know, you're going to be defense, you're going to be goalie, you're going to be forward, that's it, that's God's will. Or maybe a divine chess game where we're just pieces on a board and it's God who moves us around. Science of mind teaches us to believe that we make the choice. But beyond that, we believe that the answer to all the choices is yes. That's a pretty radical belief that would have put most of us in jail 200 years ago. And that's why it's so important to make the right choices. So the answer is always yes. If our choice is love and joy, the answer is yes. If our choice is fear and sadness, the answer is yes. A universal power flows through all of us, and its nature is to create, only to create. It doesn't decide what to create. It only says yes. We are the ones to create the form from the power. So let's go back to talking about monsters. If you look on ancient maps, you'll see them in encyclopedias and in books sometimes, the old yellow maps that were hand drawn, and you'll see written in the far edges, there might be a dragon in the water, and it'll say, here there be dragons, or on the land, here there be tigers, or here there be monsters. And you'll see this written in these corners of these maps, in these far-flung places that most people would never get a chance to go to. Now, the map makers knew darn well there was no dragons there. There was no tigers there. They probably didn't even believe in monsters, not like me. It was more likely that that location was an excellent spot to fish, like the Grand Banks, or maybe there was gold there. And the purpose of saying, here there be monsters, was to stop people from going there, because they're afraid of running into dragons. The map makers just said that there were monsters there to stop other people from finding and sharing the treasures that they knew that they were there. And that's the main point of my talk today. You and me, we can find those treasures if we stop believing in the monsters. When we stop believing that we're unworthy, we become worthy. When we stop believing that we're useless, we become purposeful. When we stop believing that we are unlovable, we are lovable. Simple, yes? Well, it's easy to say, but kind of hard to put into practice. It's one thing to know that we're spiritual beings. It's another to rise and act upon that knowing. And the strange thing about belief systems is we often don't know where they came from. Many times, we don't even know we have them. And all too often, it's difficult to change them, even if they no longer serve us. The only thing I can say is that from my personal experience, if I'm dissatisfied with something, if there's something in my life that is holding me back from the things that I want, the things that make me happy, it is always tied to some kind of belief that I hold. So it's okay to have beliefs, just don't believe them. The mind is a masterful creator and a powerful manifester. I don't know if any of you have read a short horror story called The Monkey's Paw. Maybe send up a like or something if any of you have read this story. It's called The Monkey's Paw, and it's an older story from the turn of the century, the last century, not this one. And it's about a woman who's granted three wishes on a magical talisman. It's an old, dried up monkey's paw. Sorry. Her first wish is for money, which is fine in itself. And I'm not going to tell you the details of the story, but the manifestation of her wish is cataclysmic. So she tries to correct her first wish with her second wish, which actually makes things worse. As I say, I'm not going to give you details. You need to read the story. It's a good one. Finally, her husband grabs the monkey's paw and through clear, rational thinking, makes the third wish, which cancels out the other two wishes and prevents a horrible event from occurring. Google the story, the monkey's paw. It's quite gruesome. But the monkey's paw is not really magical. It's simply a physical symbol of the universal power that says yes. That's why we say, be careful what you wish for, because it might come true. You see, we are all conduits of consciousness. I mentioned earlier, and we talk about this every week, all the time, and in our teaching, about this universal power that flows through us. Well, we're conduits of this power. Our spiritual leader of our organization, Edward Van Heune, said that we can use the creative power of our minds to channel and magnify the ultimate goodness. So let's talk about conduits. We start out on a spiritual path, but then we actually become the path. Let me say that again. We start on a spiritual path, but we become the path because we are the conduits of that power. So when we see chaos in the world, it's easy to forget that we're the conduits. Conduits of peace, conduits of joy, conduits of love. So how many monsters are stopping you from discovering your own treasures? How real are they? What are your limiting beliefs that block you from living a spiritually magnificent life? Remember, life is fully supporting us at all times. It's up to us to awaken to it. Spirituality is a path, not a destination. And sometimes we can be led astray by distractions or blocked on our journey by dragons, tigers, or monsters. But these monsters, they're only as real as we allow them to be. These words actually came up on our website, which I'm about to read, that for this month's topic. It says, pay attention when you say, I can't, because it will show you where the edges of your limitation are, where you are limiting the universe. Awaken to your truth and transcend your limiting beliefs. Thanks so much for listening. Have a happy Sunday. If you see Bigfoot, please try to take a selfie with him. But if you see Ogopogo, stand back. I hear he bites.
Neal, Klassen, way to go. That's fantastic. Oh my gosh, we are so blessed in the presence of so much wisdom and joy and fun. Have you had a good day? Have you had a good morning, and are you inspired? Are you uplifted? Then we have done our job, and now it's your turn to do your job. I know that we attract all great things into being and not monsters, just the treasures. So now's the time to bring our virtual baskets and our ushers all up. Now's the opportunity for you to share who you are with each and every one of us. And I know the Center for Spiritual Living is blessed because of it. I know that there is power in your faith, and I know that that enhances your health, your relationships, your financial support. And so if you are afeard of sharing your bounty, as Neal said, remember that you are all conduits. Conduits of great love, great abundance. And if you are thinking, and if your belief is saying, I don't want to share today, it's okay to have your beliefs, but just don't believe them. So I would love for you to repeat after me. I know that my giving blesses and multiplies all that I am, all that I have, and all that I give and receive. And today we say together, I do give eternal thanks for the abundance that is mine to share. All right, Neal, I think it's time to sing. We are so happy to see you. Have an incredible Remembrance Day long weekend. Remember to stay connected with each other on our Facebook page. You can donate to donate@cslkelowna.org. We are open to everything and everyone sharing their abundance. Come and have fun with us now. When love comes knocking at my door, I'll say yes, I'll say yes. And when love comes dancing across my floor,
I'll say yes,
I'll say yes. Oh yeah, when I need a little more of what I'm looking for, I know that I am blessed. When I say yes, just say yes, you gotta say yes. Here comes the joy is calling now. When joy comes knocking at my door, cause we're happy this week. We said yes,
I say yes.
So did the U.S. When joy comes dancing across my floor, we said yes, so did the U.S. When you need a little more of what you're looking for, I know that I am blessed. When I say yes, just say yes. Hey Kelly, hey Alan, hey Tracy, the world is calling. When the world comes dancing across my floor,
I say yes, I say yes.
And when the world comes knocking at my door, I say it, I said yes,
yeah, yeah, yeah.
When I need a little more of what I'm looking for, hey Mark, I know that I am blessed. When I say yes, just say yes, you gotta say yes. Here comes the love, the love's a raining down. When love comes knocking at my door, tap, tap, tap. What are you gonna say?
I say yes.
We all said it. And when love comes dancing past my floor,
I say yes,
say yes,
I say yes, yeah, yeah.
When I need a little more of what I'm looking for, I know that I am blessed. I said, I just said, I know you said yes. Come on, type it in there, yes. Just say, well, you just said, I heard you say yes. We're gonna do it one more time. Just say yes, we just said yes. I'm so happy we said yes.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
I love you. Go forth and shine the love and light you are.